What happens if you give Kim Taehyung from BTS a sword and send him to war? Well, I can tell you that the result probably won't be pretty. But a millennia and a half ago, in ancient Korea, he might be kicking ass left and right as a Hwarang warrior. In this episode, I will tell you all about the historical Hwarang, the kick-ass K-pop warrior of ancient Korea. If Japan's got their iconic samurai warriors, and China's got their warrior generals, then Korea's got their Hwarangs. The Hwarangs were cadets trained to be fierce patriotic warriors, almost to a fanatical degree even, who came from the kingdom of Silla, the kingdom that first united the Korean peninsula. In wars, they would fight to death for the glory of their country. Unlike the Japanese samurais, they don't do suicides. They will just keep fighting despite being outnumbered and heavily wounded to complete their mission, or until they got taken out by their enemies. Their code of honor forbade them from retreating, and their lost honor can only be regained through merit instead of suicide. In a way, that kinda makes them somewhat more efficient. If you see them on the battlefield, you'd be freaking out. And you would probably be confused too, because these lads wear makeup and know some snappy tunes. What the heck? Well, okay, that sounds a bit bonkers, but it will make sense when I explain the origin of the Hwarangs. Before Korea was unified, it was made up of many separate chiefdoms, confederacies, and kingdoms. Eventually, the number dwindled into just a few: Goguryeo, Baekje, Gaya, and Silla. Buddhism came to Silla relatively late compared to the others. Though once it became the official religion there, in 527, it became the most devoutly Buddhist one. In the last year of King Jinung of Silla's rule, before the Hwarangs were created, he created a prototype group called Unhwa, which means original flower. At the time, imperial examinations had not been implemented yet. So in order to recruit talented officers, he decided to let young people play among their peers and observe them display their talents. This experiment, however, turned out to be a bit of a disaster, to put it lightly. It wasn't known if the Unhwas were completely made up of female members, but the most talented two were Nanmao and Junjin, who were selected to lead a group of 300 followers. Eventually, they became jealous of each other's beauty and started fighting among themselves. So one day, Junchen lured Nanmao to her home and made her drink lots of wine. Once she is drunk, she was dragged to a river and drowned in it. Predictably, Junchen was executed for her crime, and the group was disbanded. King Jinung, however, had not given up on his plan yet. So in the same year, 576, he created the Hwarang organization. This time, he recruited handsome young men of good morals. They were given makeups, beautiful dress, and education in morality, music, literacy, archery, mathematics, horsemanship, and so on. As for why do they have to wear makeup? The reason was never recorded in the history books. And I kinda think that the historians felt too awkward asking why. The main sources for Hwarangs were the ancient history books Samgu Sagi, Samgu Yusa, and Haedong Gosengjan. There are some discrepancies in the accounts of Hwarangs between them. Just to give you the context, these books were written centuries after the end of the Silla Kingdom, so details are scarce and are often mixed with legends. What we do know, though, is that many of them came from aristocratic backgrounds, even coming from the family of conquered states. Perhaps the intention was to indoctrinate them with patriotism for the kingdom of Silla. The members were called Nangdo. Those in leadership were called Guksun, or Kingdom Fairy, Pungolju, or Wind and Moon Lord, and Hwarang, Flower Boy. But we don't know the exact rank of their hierarchy in relationship to each other, or when do they even graduate. Even though the Hwarangs were educated by Buddhist monks, it didn't mean that they were pacifists. They would eventually adopt the monk Wungwang's Five Commandments for Secular Life, which had a more Confucian bent. Loyalty to one's lord, devotion towards one's parents, trust among friends, never retreat in battle, and the last item on the list, be selective in the taking of life. Buddhism at this time was very influential. Not only was it Silla's official religion, it was also its legitimizing tool, as some members of the royal family claimed to be the reincarnation of the Buddha and his family members. The sect of Buddhism that influenced the Huarangs at the time was Maitreya Buddhism. It was a branch of Mahayana Buddhism that foretold the coming of a future Buddha that will one day arrive to teach the pure Dharma and basically save the world. Some Huarangs were even believed to be the reincarnation of Maitreya Buddha, and that probably fueled their zealotry. The Huarangs would often go on adventures accompanied by these Buddhist monks to offer their dance and prayers at holy mountains like Mount Kumgang. They would seek out supernatural beings like Sanshins, the Korean mountain gods, and seek blessings that benefit their kingdom. It kind of resembles King Arthur's Knight of the Round Table's quest to fetch the Holy Grail, really. I kind of think that it would also make a pretty cool Dungeons & Dragons campaign, if you ask me. Some Huarangs would end up becoming powerful leaders and generals. Some of the most famous ones among them were King Muyul, the king who laid the foundation for a unified Silla, and his general Kim Yushin, both of which were covered in a previous episode. Funnily enough, Kim Yushin was seen as a much bigger deal in Korea, with 3 chapters dedicated to his biography in Samgyeopsalgi, while even great kings like Muyul only get a few paragraphs within a chapter. There are lots of legends associated with Kim Yushin. One of the most interesting and illustrative one that described the spirit of Huarang was perhaps the martyrdom of Guancang, the 16-year-old Huarang who worked under Kim Yushin during the Battle of Hwangsunbol in 660 CE. At that time, Silla was besieging Baekje, and after a few failed assaults, the Silla forces' morale had plummeted. So Guancang's father, Pim Yi, ordered him to make a name for himself. Following his father's order, he assaulted the enemy's base, and not to anyone's surprise, he was defeated and captured. Seeing that he was just a teenager, the Baekje general spared him the first time. Not daunted by the failure, Guancang rode back and assaulted the base again. This time, only his decapitated head was returned on his horse's saddle. His sacrifice, however, stoked the fighting spirit of the Silla army, and this time they defeated Baekje. Unfortunately, the heyday of the Huarangs did not last very long. After the unification of the Korean peninsula by the Kingdom of Silla and the re-establishment of friendly relationship with Tang Dynasty China in the early 8th century, the Huarangs lost much of their purpose as elite warrior institute, and it was pretty much reduced into a social club for the young elites. They would eventually disappear after the fall of Silla, and they were largely forgotten even in Korea itself, until the end of the Second World War, when their legends were revived and turned into a patriotic symbol. Now that Korean pop groups are gaining immense popularity all over the world, exerting soft power with their Hallyu Korean wave, I guess you can almost say that they are the evolution of Huarangs. Or maybe not. Tell us what you think in the comments. Anyway, subscribe to the channel if you liked the video and want to see more on the history of Asia and the rest of the world. If you would like to participate in the discussion and vote on future topics, then be a bro or a hyung and join us on Patreon. You can also help the channel by liking, sharing, and commenting, because it boosts the algorithm. Until next time, stay cool, my bros.